Hello and welcome to, well, this, you clicked on this video because you saw the words North Korea and thought, ooh, spicy. North Korea has a reputation and it's not for being the Switzerland of Asia. We're talking about a country shrouded in more secrecy than a Kardashian family recipe for salad. A land where the internet is more restricted than my Tinder profile after a brutal string of bad dates. So buckle up, Buttercup, because we're diving headfirst into the enigmatic, the bizarre, and the frankly terrifying world of North Korea. Let's start with the man himself, the supreme leader, Kim Jong-un. You know, the guy with the haircut that looks like it's trying to escape his head? Yeah, him. He wasn't educated in North Korea, but in Switzerland. Yes, Switzerland, land of chocolate and neutrality. Odd, right? And you'd be right, it is odd. Little Kim Jong-un attended a school near Bern under the name Park-un, with a fake name and a security detail. He loved basketball, Van Damme films, and maintaining an iron grip on power. Now, before you start picturing Kim Jong-un as some sort of literary Hercules, churning out novels, philosophical treatises, and maybe even a cookbook or two, let's consider the logistics. 1,500 books during his university years, which, if we're being generous, let's say lasted for 5 years. That's 300 books a year. Or to put it another way, a book a day, except for weekends, because even dictators need a break. Now, I'm no literary scholar, but that seems a tad ambitious, even for someone who's allegedly able to control the weather with his moods. What were these books about, you ask? Well, according to North Korean propaganda, they were masterpieces on a variety of subjects, from philosophy to economics to military strategy. However, given that the only people who've allegedly read these books are North Korean citizens forced to memorize them for their own safety, we have to take these claims with the North Korean salt mine, which is to say a very large grain of salt. So, did Kim Jong-un actually write 1,500 books? Probably not. Is it a hilarious and terrifying example of North Korean propaganda? Absolutely. And does it make me question my own productivity levels? You bet your sweet capitalist behind it does. North Korea, officially the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, or DPRK, if you're feeling fancy, is often referred to as the Hermit Kingdom. And much like that one weird uncle who lives in a cabin and only communicates through cryptic messages carved into potatoes, North Korea really doesn't like interacting with the outside world. They've got more walls up than a teenager's MySpace page in 2005. Seriously, their internet access is so restricted that you're more likely to find a unicorn riding a Segway through Pyongyang than you are to find a North Korean citizen browsing Reddit. And don't even get me started on their phone system. It's like trying to make a long-distance call with two tin cans and a really, really long piece of string. This isolation is, of course, all part of the government's plan to control the narrative. They want to ensure that the only information their citizens receive is the information they deem acceptable. Think of it as a nationwide game of telephone, except the message always ends with, "And then the glorious leader, Kim Jong-un, single-handedly defeated a giant squid using only a rusty spork and his bare hands." Now you might be thinking, but John, what about all those tourists who visit North Korea? Surely they see what's really going on. And to that, I say, bless your naive little heart. Tourists in North Korea are about as free as a hamster on one of those tiny hamster wheels. They're constantly accompanied by government minders who dictate their every move, from the sights they see to the conversations they're allowed to have. It's like a carefully curated theme park experience, except instead of Mickey Mouse and overpriced churros, you get propaganda posters and the lingering fear of accidentally saying something that lands you in a labor camp. So yeah, not exactly a relaxing vacation destination. All right, let's talk stadiums, specifically the Rungrado 1st of May Stadium in Pyongyang. This thing makes the Super Bowl look like a cozy gathering in your nan's backyard. It can hold 150,000 people, which is, frankly, more people than I want to be in a room with at any given time, even if they were all there to declare their undying love for me. Now, you might be thinking, a stadium that big, they must have a cracking football team. Well, not quite. It's mainly used for the Arirang Festival, a massive gymnastics and artistic performance, and trust me, it's about as subtle as a glitter cannon in a library. But here's the thing. Despite having this colossal stadium, North Korea's national football team has only been to the World Cup twice. Twice! You'd think with a home advantage like that, they'd be winning trophies left, right and centre. It's like having a Ferrari and only ever driving it to the grocery store. Just baffling. Now, I know what you're thinking. John, this is all well and good, but what's the point of a giant stadium in a country that seemingly doesn't use it to its full potential? Well, my friends, that's the million-dollar question, isn't it? Some say it's a symbol of national pride, a way for North Korea to flex its architectural muscles on the world stage. Others argue it's a propaganda tool, a concrete behemoth designed to inspire awe and obedience in its citizens. And then there's the theory that it's just a really, really big place to hold a picnic. I mean, who doesn't love a good picnic? Although, I imagine the catering bill for 150,000 people would be absolutely eye-watering, whatever the reason. One thing's for sure. The Rungrado 1st of May Stadium is a fascinating and somewhat perplexing testament to the unique nature of North Korea. Speaking of perplexing, let's talk about the Arirang Festival, shall we? This ain't your average village fete with a bouncy castle and a dodgy raffle. Oh no, this is a synchronized spectacle of epic proportions featuring tens of thousands of performers moving in perfect unison. It's basically Busby Berkeley on steroids, with a healthy dose of socialist realism thrown in for good measure. Imagine this, a sea of brightly colored costumes, intricate formations shifting before your eyes, and a soundtrack that could rival the most dramatic opera. It's enough to make your head spin, and that's before we even get to the human mosaics. Yes, you heard me right, human mosaics. Imagine thousands of people holding up colored cards like pixelated humans, creating giant images of North Korean leaders, national symbols, and frankly baffling slogans. It's like a giant game of Tetris, but with significantly higher stakes. Now, it's no surprise that an event of this magnitude has caught the attention of the Guinness World Records folks. Because what's a massive, meticulously choreographed display of national pride without a shiny certificate to validate it? The Arirang Festival holds the record for the largest gymnastic and artistic performance, which, let's be honest, is a pretty niche category. But hey, a win's a win, right? Of course, the festival has been criticized for its propagandistic elements, with some calling it a glorified display of state control. And they're not wrong, it's hard to ignore the overt messaging and the sheer scale of the event, which can feel a little, shall we say, big brotherish. But it's also a fascinating glimpse into North Korean culture, showcasing the dedication, discipline, and, dare I say, artistry of its people. It's a complex and contradictory event, much like the country itself. Now let's talk about something a little less whimsical and a lot more, shall we say, explosive. North Korea's military, this isn't just your average run-of-the-mill defense force. Oh no, this is the fourth largest military in the world, boasting over 1 million active soldiers. To put that into perspective, that's more people than the entire population of Fiji. And it's not just the sheer number of soldiers that's impressive or terrifying, depending on your perspective. It's the sheer amount of firepower they have at their disposal. We're talking tanks, artillery, and enough missiles to make even the most trigger-happy dictator blush. But here's the kicker. North Korea also has a massive reserve force, estimated to be in the millions. That's right, millions of people who are, in theory, ready to drop whatever they're doing and mobilize for their country at a moment's notice. I mean, talk about commitment. Now, you might be thinking, John, is this all just for show? Are these guys all bark and no bite? Well, that's the million-dollar question, isn't it? While North Korea's military might seem impressive on paper, their equipment is often outdated and their training, well, let's just say, it leaves something to be desired. But that doesn't mean they're not a force to be reckoned with. Their sheer unpredictability makes them dangerous. And their willingness to use force, as evidenced by their numerous provocations over the years, is a cause for concern. So while we can marvel at the sheer scale of their military, let's not forget the very real threat they pose to regional stability and global security. Because behind the parades and the propaganda lies a complex and volatile reality. Think you know North Korea? You've got the basics, the Kim dynasty, the isolation, the giant stadium, but let's delve into the bizarre. Time in North Korea. North Korea uses the Juche calendar introduced in 1997. Year one marks the birth of Kim Il-sung in 1912. While it's 2023 for us, it's Juche 112 in North Korea. Imagine restarting the calendar with Guy Fieri's birth. It's all about control. Because this obsession with the Juche calendar isn't just some quirky footnote. Oh no, it permeates North Korean society. Newspapers, official documents, even birthday cakes. They all proudly display the Juche year. It's a constant reminder that in North Korea, time itself bows down to the Kim dynasty. And if you're thinking, well, that's just their internal system, surely they acknowledge the Gregorian calendar for international dealings? Well, you'd be partially right. They do use the Gregorian calendar when they absolutely have to, for things like, you know, international sporting events where showing up 90 years late might raise an eyebrow or two. But internally, it's Juche all the way down. Imagine the mental gymnastics involved in constantly switching between two different calendars. It's enough to give you a migraine, and that's before we even factor in the potential for propaganda-induced existential dread. But hey, at least it makes for some interesting trivia, right? Next time you're at a pub quiz and someone asks, what year is it in North Korea, you can impress your friends with your encyclopedic knowledge of totalitarian calendar systems. Just maybe don't mention how you learned it from a YouTube video narrated by a disembodied British voice. That might raise some eyebrows. All right, let's move on from the mind-bending world of the Juche calendar to something a little more relatable. The internet, we all love it, we all hate it. It's a cesspool of misinformation and cat videos, and it's completely inescapable, unless, of course, you live in North Korea. Because in the Hermit Kingdom, the internet, as we know it, basically doesn't exist. Instead, they have something called Kwangmyong. And no, it's not some mystical word for enlightenment through technology. It's basically a heavily censored, government-controlled intranet. Imagine the world's most boring LAN party with all the excitement of a dial-up connection and all the freedom of a state-run library. Access is limited, speeds are glacial, and the content is about as diverse as a beige paint swatch. The government tightly regulates who gets access to Kwangmyong and what they can do on it. Think of it like a walled garden, but instead of flowers and butterflies, it's just rows upon rows of carefully curated propaganda and the occasional recipe for kimchi stew. And if you're thinking of hopping onto a VPN and sneaking a peek at the outside world, well, good luck with that. North Korea has some of the most sophisticated internet censorship technology in the world. They've got firewalls so thick you could project the entirety of the interview onto them and still not get through. And if you do somehow manage to bypass the great firewall of Pyongyang, let's just say the consequences are unlikely to be pleasant. We're talking potential imprisonment, torture, or worse. So yeah, maybe stick to reading physical books and having actual human conversations if you ever find yourself in North Korea. It's safer that way. And look, I know what you're thinking, John. This is all very bleak. Is there anything remotely positive about North Korea's relationship with the internet? And the answer, surprisingly, is yes. All right, let's move on from the digital wasteland that is the North Korean internet to something a little more tangible, the capital city of Pyongyang. Now, Pyongyang is a fascinating study in contrast. On the one hand, it's a city meticulously crafted to project an image of prosperity and progress. Think wide avenues, towering monuments, and buildings so bright and colorful they'd make a bag of Skittles jealous. It's like someone took the set design for a utopian science fiction film and plopped it right in the middle of North Korea. But beneath this carefully constructed facade lies a more complex reality. Pyongyang is a city of stark inequalities, where access and privilege are determined by your loyalty to the regime. Think of it like a giant real-life game of SimCity, but the only way to level up is through unwavering devotion to the Kim dynasty. And if you're not lucky enough to be a member of the chosen few, well, let's just say life in Pyongyang might not be quite the socialist paradise it's made out to be. You see, Pyongyang is essentially a closed city. Not just anyone can pack their bags and move to the capital. You need permission from the government to live there, and that permission is granted based on a complex system of social ranking known as songbun. Think of it like a credit score, but it measures your loyalty to the state, and if your score isn't high enough, forget about ever stepping foot in Pyongyang. Only the most loyal get to enjoy the perks of life in the capital. For the average citizen, life in Pyongyang is still a struggle. All right, let's talk about Kijongdong, a village that exists solely to convince outsiders that North Korea is a utopia. Yes, you heard that right. It's literally a Potemkin village, like something out of a particularly bleak satire. Now, on the surface, Kijongdong seems idyllic. It boasts brightly painted apartment buildings, well-maintained farms, and even a hospital. Residents supposedly enjoy short work days, high-quality healthcare, and a life of leisure. It's the kind of place where the cows probably produce full-fat milk and the chickens lay only organic free-range eggs. But here's the catch. No one actually lives in this paradise. Well, almost no one. There have been reports of carefully selected caretakers and military personnel inhabiting the village, essentially playing the role of happy citizens for the occasional tourist bus that rolls through. It's all a carefully constructed facade, a theatrical production designed to project an image of prosperity and contentment to the outside world. And honestly, you have to admire the sheer audacity of it all. It's like North Korea took the concept of a staged house tour and said, "Hold my beer." Peeking behind the curtain of Kijongdong reveals bizarre details. Lights are kept on to maintain the illusion of occupancy. Those happy farmers, rumored to be soldiers. The village is heavily guarded, access strictly controlled. The closest you can get is peering through binoculars. Facades eventually crumble. The truth about Kijongdong cannot be hidden forever. Let's talk about cultural influence, or rather, the distinct lack thereof in North Korea. Now, I'm not saying that the country is devoid of culture. Take the internet, for example. Instead, they have access to a highly censored intranet known as Kwangmyong. The regime has its own brand of state-sanctioned entertainment, aggressively cheerful and devoid of irony. North Koreans are treated to a steady diet of patriotic songs, military parades, and films extolling their leaders. Now, this cultural isolation extends beyond the digital realm and into the very fabric of everyday life. Literally, you see, in North Korea, even your clothing choices are subject to strict regulations. Want to rock a pair of blue jeans? Tough luck, comrade. Those are symbols of Western imperialism and are strictly forbidden. And don't even think about expressing your individuality with a little piercing or a funky haircut. The government has a very specific idea of what a model citizen should look like, and let's just say it's not exactly cutting edge. Think more Soviet-era factory worker and less Brooklyn hipster. But here's the thing about cultural repression. It's like trying to hold back the tide with a sieve. Despite their best efforts, outside influences are slowly but surely seeping into North Korea. Whether it's smuggled foreign films, whispered stories from defectors, or the faint echo of a K-pop song drifting across the border, the regime can't control everything. And that, my friends, is a glimmer of hope. Because culture, like water, will always find a way. And who knows? Maybe one day, the streets of Pyongyang will be filled with people rocking their best denim and listening to whatever music their hearts desire. A guy can dream, can't he? So there you have it. A glimpse into the enigmatic and often baffling world of North Korea. It's a place where propaganda reigns supreme, cultural expression is tightly controlled, and the outside world is kept at arm's length. But it's also a place of surprising contradictions, where ancient traditions coexist with modern technology and a deep sense of national pride runs alongside a profound sense of isolation. Remember, what we've seen is just a small window into a complex and often misunderstood nation. There's still so much we don't know about North Korea, and it's important to approach this subject with nuance and a healthy dose of skepticism. After all, in a country where even the villages are staged, it's crucial to question everything and to remember that behind the carefully constructed facade, there are real people living real lives.